Good morning. So today I did the two fibroadenoma last week, but some images like the PowerPoint, I was not able to show all the images that I wanted to show. So I'm just going to run through it again. So the breast is actually anatomically made up of what we call as building blocks, that is the terminal ductal lobular units, which the acinar tissue of which produces the milk. And then we have those terminal ductal lobular units together in a branch fashion makes the lobes of the breast. And this fibrous tissue and fat. So these are the components in the breast. And most of the pathology happens around this terminal ductal lobular unit. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, we can.
So the most of the pathology happens here, and it also follows a pattern. So if you see in the reproductive age group, there is from menarche to menopause, there is a steady process of proliferation and involution. So these TDLUs are formed with the hormonal response. So there is a proliferative component followed by an involutional component. So every time when the pregnancy doesn't happen, there is no breastfeeding to happen, then some of the TDLUs that are formed involute and disappear. And then for the next cycle, again, more TDLUs are formed in anticipation of a possible pregnancy. After all, its job is to produce milk. Then if it doesn't happen, there is more involution. This happens cyclically, and this is a normal change in the breast. So what you find then with advancing age, so the younger age group in the 20s and 30s, proliferative component is more. So as age advances, you see there is less proliferation, but more involution. So more and more tissue, the TDLUs are involuting, and then the fibroglandular breast tissue gets replaced by fat. So that is why you see a mammogram like this. If you do a mammogram in a young woman, you see only what we call as dense breast. So this is because the fibroglandular tissue images as white structure. So it is all because dense fibroglandular tissue, more of proliferation happening, that it is all white like this. So which is why we don't do mammograms in younger age group, because if it is going to be like that, the malignancy also is white and calcifications are white. It's very difficult to image or see through those lesions in a dense parenchyma like this. So which is why mammograms are not advocated routinely in women, very young women. But as age advances, the fibroglandular tissue over a period involutes, and you will see only fibrous strands left, and most of it gets replaced by fat. So this is what we call as a fatty breast. So in a fatty breast, so with age, in a fatty breast like this, if there is a malignant lesion or microcalcifications, it's very easy to see, which is why you know, women over 40, mammogram actually serves as a good investigation to pick up malignancies. So pathology, like I said, is related to the changes that happens around that age. So in the early age, fibroadenomas are more common, because this is when there is more proliferative changes that are happening. So both the terminal ductal lobular unit and the mesenchymal tissue surrounding the terminal ductal lobular unit, both proliferate together. They become bigger in size and more in number and encapsulated. That is what we call as fibroadenoma. So what happens with the cyst? So when you have the acinar tissue is lining all these little ductules, the acinar structure, and when involution happens, the involution happens here first, in the ductule first. So when the ductules involute and close off, the fluid that is normally produced doesn't have any egress outside. So it kind of balloons out and swells, and that is what we call as cysts. So these some of them are very small microcysts, some become bigger and form bigger cysts that are palpable sometimes. So So obviously, this, because this happens around involution, where involution is predominant, cysts are more common in the perimenopausal age group after the age of 40-45 till menopause, till well 2 to 3 years after menopause, cysts can occur. So in this graph, if you see, the incidence of fibroadenoma peaks in the 20s and 30s, whereas the cyst actually peaks around 40s, 50s and around menopause. And cancer steadily in the incidence increases from about 35, 40 and 60 and beyond. And there is diffuse nodularity, this aberration and involution and development and involution, that actually peaks around the mid 30s. And that also tapers down post-menopause. Fibroadenomas are very common in young women. These can be multiple, bilateral, and it behaves like breast tissue. It is breast tissue. It is like normal breast tissue. This also has TDLUs, and more in number, bigger in size, encapsulated in one particular area. They do not communicate to ductal systems. It behaves like breast tissue. So in response to hormones, this will also change. So when there is increase in size during pregnancy, see, normally the TDLUs are about 1 to 2 millimeters in size. With pregnancy and breastfeeding, it increases in size up to 4-5 millimeters because its job is to make milk. So when it increases during pregnancy and lactation, so like the TDLUs everywhere else increasing, the TDLUs within the fibroadenoma also can increase during pregnancy and lactation. In fact, it can produce milk also. This milk, because it does not communicate with the rest of the system, it accumulates within the fibroadenoma. And that is why sometimes it looks very odd when you image them during pregnancy and lactation. And it is this which later, when there is myxoid degeneration along with this inspissated milk, that actually calcify later into popcorns. So some fibroadenomas, about a third of them may involute, particularly if they are small, they may also involute like normal breast tissue and disappear spontaneously. Some actually undergo some myxoid degeneration, and the inspissated content also can actually calcify over time, and they become popcorn-like calcifications, macro calcifications in the breast. So any amount of oil of evening primrose or vitamin E does not help in making these fibroadenomas go away. So the importance of fibroadenoma earlier, to when we were all training in medical college, only women with ultrasound was rare. It was available there, but not every place had ultrasound. So the women with palpable lumps only were examined, and most lumps at that time, we were excising all of the palpable lumps and debating which incision to use, and all that happened at that time. But over a period, what happened? Ultrasound became very easily available, and every breast symptom, you know, a little breast pain here, a little discomfort there, everybody had ultrasound done, and some included routinely in the mastoid checkup also. So this resulted in picking up of a lot of asymptomatic nodules in the breast, which like, you know, even today there is no clear guidelines for most people about how to do, what to do with these lumps. But generally, as a rule, if it's a symptomatic lump in the breast in women under 35 years of age, we should do an ultrasound first. On ultrasound, if there is any suspicious feature on the ultrasound finding, then the mammogram also should be combined. Otherwise, an ultrasound is fine. So these fibroadenomas have, majority of them, I won't say all of them, majority of them have a distinct benign appearance. So because it's benign, it is not aggressively growing, it respects tissue planes and pushes itself into the breast tissue to grow. So you will find a very well circumscribed, transversely oriented lesions when you examine, and with the clear margins. So the echogenicity, when the sound waves pass through the lump, the sound waves, some of them pass beyond the lesion posteriorly, some get stopped there, and then you see after shadowing. So here the echogenicity is hypoechoic. Normally we set the echogenicity, the machine is calibrated to to show fat in a medium gray. If you keep seeing it, you get used to it. What is medium gray? What is hypoechoic? What is anechoic? What is isoechoic? So all of these things over a period you will come to know, but it's important to understand these words. So and it can be gently lobulated. It some of these things tend to grow, they need its blood supply, so they will have some peripheral vascularity. So I'll talk to you more about peripheral vascularity later, and what is peripheral and what is central vascularity. But most of these things if may have a peripheral vascularity, and coarse calcifications on a mammogram, you might find some popcorn like coarse calcifications. So I'll show you some images now. So if you see, so this is more transverse than it's vertical. So if it is more transverse in orientation, transverse diameter is more than the vertical diameter, then it is usually benign. And if you see the margin, they're quite circumscribed, very sharp and circumscribed. If you see all of these lesions, they're quite sharp and circumscribed. So this also is suggestive of a benign feature. And if you look at these echogenicity, so this is the surrounding tissue. If you see the surrounding tissue in relation to the surrounding fat, what is the echogenicity here? It's darker. Again, here in relation to this, this is darker. In relation to this, this is darker. So that is hypoechoic. And so these three things you have to look for. When you see a ultrasound image, check the shape first. Is it oval? Is it rounded? Or is it irregular? Look at the margins. Is it circumscribed or is it irregular? Are there any angles in it? So that is something you have to look at, which differentiates it from benign and malignant. And the orientation, is it transversely oriented or vertically oriented? So most fibroadenomas or most benign lesions are transversely oriented. So the next thing, like I said about echogenicity, next thing you look at is echogenicity. So for this, echogenicity is largely observer dependent, or the dependent on the person who's doing it. Because if they set the grayscale wrong in the machine, it can be, you can make a very a hypoechoic lesion anechoic, you can make a hypoechoic lesion isoechoic. So the grayscale, setting that grayscale is important, and that comes with experience. So if you see, this is hypoechoic, and which is darker than the surrounding fat tissue. But here, if you see, it's more or less similar to this color. So this I would call as isoechoic. So if not for this nicely encapsulated margin, circumscribed margin, there won't be much difference between this tissue surrounding fat and this. So that is similar, isoechoic. And sorry, you said something? So, and then the next feature you would look at on ultrasound is what happens to the sound waves behind the lesion. So when you put the probe there, the transducer sends all those sound waves, it passes through this lesion. And if it is a very cellular lesion, and it depends on the hyaluronic acid content and the cellular water content, you see posterior attenuation, it becomes brighter behind. And so this being brighter behind usually is a sign of benign lesion. Sometimes you may not have any posterior feature. So if it is not there also, again, it is more likely to be benign. On the other hand, if you have a dense shadowing behind, it could be malignant. The exception being an involuting fibroadenoma. So here, if you see, that is why you should always look at, if you see an ultrasound, always look at the mammogram and see, does whatever is there, does it correspond in terms of location and the finding. So here you see, this is a very coarse calcification. This coarse calcification is typical popcorn, like, you know, it looks like a little popcorn or a coral like appearance. So this obviously is stone, isn't it? It's calcification, meaning it's stone hard. So obviously the sound waves are not going to go through and behind. So that is why when the sound waves get trapped here and it doesn't go behind, then you get this dense shadowing. So this, if you didn't have this image and you had only this, this could be a suspicious lesion, a malignant lesion. That's why you should always look at both the imaging. Ultrasound alone is not sufficient. You should also look at mammogram. So you look at the mammogram, then look at this. If the location matches, then you know this is not a malignant lesion. This is just an involuting fibroadenoma, and you don't need to do anything further. So in some women, actually, fibroadenoma nodules like this. So this woman incidentally happened to have a routine checkup. She didn't feel anything. But if you see here, there are multiple lesions. And at least you can count sometimes 10, 15 lesions in some patients in the same breast. So then you look at features again, go one by one. Look at the orientation, look at the margin, look at the echogenicity, look at the vascularity. So this is what I meant by peripheral vascularity. The blood, when you put the color Doppler in on the ultrasound machine, you find that the blood supply is towards the periphery. And if it's peripheral, it's usually a growing lump, but it is usually benign. So these are all, so this is what I meant by central. So in the middle of the lesion, you find significant looking vessels, then it could be, this is central vascularity. So this lesion, if you look at it, it is transverse. There are some irregular areas in the margin. It's circumscribed, right? But there are some irregularities in the margin. Also, if you see this one, there are some gentle lobulations. It's transversely oriented, but the way these lobulations, there are more than two or three lobulations. And again, here, if you see, there are more than two or three lobulations. So these kind of lesions would be categorized as Bi-RADS 4B or even C, because these needs to be biopsied. But on biopsy, all these three lesions turned out to be fibroadenomas. So these are what we call as complex fibroadenomas. So not all fibroadenomas are straightforward benign looking lesions. About 60% of them would fall under the category which I showed earlier. A good 30 to 40% of them look like this. So this is where actually one should have a very low threshold for biopsy. So these kind of images, until proven otherwise, you should take it as malignancy biopsy. And biopsy shows fibroadenoma, then even then I would be still wary of leaving these lumps behind. So these are the lumps. So these are the lumps which I will plan a surgical excision. So something like this, definitely no. These are lesions which I will ignore surgically. I'd say just come back to me after 6 months, two six months period. We'll see if it doesn't grow. I would just leave it like that. This I will just ignore it at all, not even call for follow-up. And these I might call for follow-up once in 6 months for a couple of times. And if they all remain stable, then not do anything further. But these lumps, I would definitely biopsy. And even on biopsy, if there is a diagnosis of a fibroepithelial lesion, I would still excise. This is what I would call as RAD path discordance, radiology pathology discordance. So it looks suspicious to me on radiology, but pathologists tell me that it is a benign lesion. I still won't leave it at that. I would excise it. And these are the lesions which should be excised with the margin. Orient the margins and send it for pathology. Then if it is clearly benign, then nothing further needs to be done. She just needs to come for a couple of times annual follow-ups. That's all. So these are all some mammographic images. If you see, this is, again, mammography we do only if there is, in women under 35, if there is a suspicious looking ultrasound, then we do a mammogram. Otherwise, for breast imaging, for any triple assessment would naturally involve a mammogram also. So this is again on a mammogram also, you find a nice smooth marginated oval lesion. If you see, there's another one here, which is what is magnified here. Nice circumscribed smooth margin, again ovoid in nature. And like you see echogenicity in the breast, in mammogram, we call it density. So is it hyperdense, isodense, or hypodense? So it's more dense than the surrounding breast tissue. It is it's usually a malignant lesion. If it is isodense or hypodense, then it could be a fibroadenoma. So if you see this, compared to the surrounding breast tissue in the mammogram, it is of the same density. It is of the same density. You almost actually miss this lesion. Here it is a little in the fatty area, so it won't, this obviously the density when it is seen along with the breast tissues only when you need to look at it more carefully. So if you see, these are also circumscribed masses, and you find what is called as a halo sign in benign lumps. If you see these, there is a sharp black line. If you see a sharp black line in the periphery of this lesion. So this is like a halo. And this usually means that the lesion is benign, because malignant lesions will have spicules and some host reaction surrounding the tumor. The tumor is recognized by the body as something different, and there will be a host reaction. So this host reaction will make actually the margin surrounding the tissue, surrounding the zone surrounding the lesion appear white, and then there may be spicules actually. But in a benign lesion, you don't find that host reaction. And so therefore there will be a halo, like a black shadow. So if you see again carefully, so it's the same image here. So correlating the mammogram and ultrasound, you can see how it looks. So this is hypoechoic, and the same sharp margins you see, that ovoid appearance and shape. And similarly here, so this margin is more or less circumscribed. Similarly here, and if you see again, ovoid transverse in orientation, sharper margin, circumscribed. Behind here, there is attenuation. Here, there's not much posterior feature. And then these are, again, fibroadenomas, when they age and get involuted, then they calcify like this. So this is actually the lesion into which there is myxoid tissue, which myxoid degeneration, which actually calcifies like that. And if you see, this again is the fibroadenoma. Parts of this fibroadenoma is getting calcified. Here again, you see, this is the lesion. And within that, parts of these lesions, they're getting calcified. Again, you can see the outline of the lesion and the calcification that is happening within. So sometimes when these fibroadenomas involute and the calcification, the process of calcification happens, and at that point in time, if you end up doing a mammogram for screening or opportunistic screening, whatever else, or from some other symptom, then you find a finding like this is very difficult to differentiate it from a DCIS. So this is actually suspicious, because this in the beginning when it calcifies, it appears like that, and then more coarsely chunky process happens later. But when you see like this, then this always poses a dilemma. Is it a malignancy or is it an involuting calcification? Because it's very difficult to differentiate at this point. And if you end up waiting too long, and if it is malignancy, then it becomes a bigger mass. And if it's, so which is why we need to biopsy. So these are lesions that are not felt by hand, that are difficult to be seen on ultrasound also. So this is when you have suspicious calcifications like that, you need a stereotactic biopsy. So as far as fibroadenomas are concerned, I think from what we discussed earlier, I think it is very clear. Is it, when you see a fibroadenoma, the most important question is it only a fibroadenoma or am I missing a malignancy? So does all fibroadenomas need biopsy? Should all of them need to be removed surgically? And is there any medical management? So these are the five questions that we have to answer for ourselves. So, if it is a very clear fibroadenoma, something like this, in a young woman, obviously this can be ignored. This nothing needs to be done. This is in a woman who's 40 or 45 who has a screening mammogram, even in her case, this can be left alone. This I would biopsy, because one margin is not that very clear. And again, here it's not very sharp. So this is something I would call as a BI-RADS 4A and biopsy. So these are all lesions that, so this again, something like this, I would biopsy. So if the lesion does not exhibit all the benign features, that is oval in shape, sharp rounded margin, hypoechoic or isoechoic, peripheral vascularity or no vascularity, no posterior shadowing, and no irregularity or microlobulations. So, and if it's a young woman less than 30 years of age, I would say come back for follow-up 6 months later. But any other feature, even one feature that it is different, then those are the ones that needs to be biopsied. So I'll now show you some, because the in the pretext of a fibroadenoma, we should not miss a cancer. That is the worry. So I'm going to show you some images which all look like. So if you look at this lesion, so on a mammogram, this is a nice ovoid lesion and isodense with the rest of the breast parenchymal tissue. And she's 32. One might be tempted to call it benign and and not do anything further. So she has first an ultrasound because she's 32, less than 35. So we do an ultrasound first. Now why did I do a mammogram here? Because if you see on ultrasound, the margins are not very sharp. You see there is some irregularity here. And here also it is ovoid here if you look at it in one angle, but the margins are not very sharp. There is some slight lobulations, what we call as microlobulations. So which is why I converted this into a mammogram, did an additional mammogram. And here, sometimes when you do mammography, I'll tell you about what are all the sites to look for at a malignancy, for a malignancy. So this is the retromammary area. Anything here should always be investigated, because retromammary area, you get usually only fat. You hardly get any breast tissue. If you look at this, this is a pre-mammary area, mammary zone, and this is a retromammary zone. Retromammary, if there is any lesion there, it should always be considered until proven otherwise malignancy, worked up and rule out malignancy. So then she had a core biopsy and it turned out to be a medullary carcinoma. So medullary carcinomas can look very similar to a fibroadenoma. And the age group also, medullary carcinomas tend to occur in the younger age group. These medullary carcinomas are likely to be associated with BRCA mutation. So they occur in the younger age group. And these are the ones that we should not miss in the pretext of a fibroadenoma. So if you look here, this is again an ovoid lesion. One margin is not clear. So there is a little tail-like extension. One margin is not clear. You even see a thin line here, that what looks like a halo sign. So if you see it here, there is a halo sign, but one margin is not very clear. So, and she's 40. So she had a mammogram and an ultrasound. And if you look at this, this is again very ovoid, circumscribed, no posterior feature. This is on ultrasound. It's hypoechoic. But what made me biopsy this was this tail. So you see that tail there, this tail. This is what we call as a comet tail sign. So any tail-like extension in the mammogram or continuation with a duct-like structure in an ultrasound, the suspicion should be there that it is malignant and biopsy should be done. So in biopsy, it turned out to be again a medullary carcinoma. So this lady had a strong family history as well. Now look at this. So this again is a CC and MLO view, and it's an ovoid lesion or maybe rounded lesion, whatever you, it's somewhere in between. And it's quite well circumscribed all around. And it's very tempting to call this benign. So look at this lesion here as well. I don't know if you see the full lesion, but again, ovoid, some bit of margin irregularity is here. But what is happening here is this is so bright with blood supply. You put the Doppler on, there's so many blood vessels. So what it means is it's a very aggressively growing malignancy. So fibroadenomas also can have vascularity, but when you have something like this, this automatically don't dismiss this lump as fibroadenoma and ask her to come for 6 months follow-up. This should be biopsy. So this turned out to be a triple negative breast cancer. So the triple negative cancers, these high-grade cancers in young women, they grow so fast that it doesn't give a breather for the host tissue, the surrounding normal tissue, to exhibit a reaction, to exhibit spicules, to exhibit the scirrhous pattern of host reaction. So here it grows, and that is why it also, because it grows so fast, it needs so much blood supply as well. And it pushes itself to grow rather than infiltrate. And that's why these triple negative cancers look like fibroadenoma. So I've seen time and again, a lot of radiologists calling this. This usually happens in younger women in their 30s and early 30s. And time and again, radiologists call this benign. And the most gynecologists who see them first miss it and ask them to come for a 6 months follow-up, by which time it becomes so big and metastasizes. So it's very important not to miss these lesions. So again, look at this lesion. This is again an ovoid lesion. and one or two gentle lobulations, maybe a little bit more than what I could would care. And again, it's hypoechoic. There's not much posterior feature. And mammographically, it's isodense to the rest of the tissue. So, and again, if I have more than one or two lobulations, then I would call this as Bi-RADS 4A and biopsy. Certainly, if she's definitely, this lesion is something that I would biopsy, even if she was only 25 or 30. So these are the lesions that you have to have a low threshold to biopsy. This also turned out to be a malignancy. And look at this here. This is an older woman, slightly older woman. Again, very sharp, sharply marginated, nice, benign looking lesion, very innocent looking lesion on a mammogram. But one thing, so ovoid is okay, but round is not okay. Round lesion should be biopsy. Unless proven otherwise, take it as round hypoechoic lesions, work them up backwards, take it as malignancy and then disprove it or prove it otherwise. So this lesion, again, if you see, this is round lesion and I don't know if it is visible, there were one or two spicules, like lines there. And here, if you see, this is a nice round looking lesion, hypoechoic, not much happening behind. But when you see, there is quite a lot of vascularity within the lesion. And this biopsy turned out to be a triple negative breast cancer. So these are the lesions that we should not miss. Here again, this is a much older lady. And because I've labeled it here, it's mucinous cancer. Mucinous cancer occurs in older women. Also, if you see, the breast is very fatty. And you look at this lesion, it's again rounded, circumscribed lesion. But you see a little tail, this is a comet tail. You see this little tail and angle there. So when you see a spicule kind of thing, so these actually should raise the suspicion in you. And you do a ultrasound. So this is more vertically oriented. It's hypoechoic, sharp. And if you see, there is mucinous cancer. There is a lot of mucin, lakes of mucin within the lesion. And this mucin behaves like water, isn't it, with sound waves. So the sound waves pass beyond the lesion and it actually attenuates here behind. So that's why you see this brighter shadow. Benign lesions usually have that. The exception being a well-differentiated mucinous cancer. So this again, one might actually pass it off as a benign lesion if they're not aware of such things. So this is again something that needs to be biopsied and it turns out to be mucinous cancer. So look at this again. I'm showing you a lot of these images because it should get imprinted in your mind to have a low threshold to biopsy. Don't ignore these lesions. Again, this is, I don't have the age here, but whatever. This is again a round looking lesion. Like I said, oval is okay, but round, anything round, a cyst can be round. But a solid lesion that is round, it has to be biopsied. Round is not reassuring. Round has to be biopsied. So look at this lesion again. Dense, white mass, circumscribed. Not much host reaction on a mammogram here. Look at the ultrasound. So again, hypoechoic, sharp margins, circumscribed margins, and posterior attenuation is there. It is a lot brighter behind. No surrounding host reaction. But on ultrasound, on Doppler, it shows some blood vessels. Not a lot, but it shows some blood vessels. So because I don't like round lesions, I end up biopsying this, and it turns out to be medullary cancer. So why I'm showing all of these cancers with fibroadenoma is because these are the lesions that get labeled as fibroadenomas outside. These are the lesions that people without experience in these areas, when they do ultrasound, they just call it as Bi-RADS 3 fibroadenoma. And then it goes to a gynecologist or a surgeon who's not very clear about these things. They either ignore it and ask them to come for a 6 months follow-up, or sometimes assuming it's benign, excise it, and after excision, it turns out to be malignant. So this is why it is important to see these images and imprint it in your mind and have a low threshold to biopsy. And it doesn't hurt. No, biopsy will prove it one way or the other. And if you don't biopsy, then you could potentially be missing a cancer. So what do we do? Treatment in very young girls, if it's radiologically clearly benign, then no sign, not even a single sign of suspicious lesion, then follow up only. In older women, we obviously do a core biopsy. And if there is any radiology pathology discordance, then it has to be excised or follow up accordingly. So like I said, beware of a well-differentiated malignancy. Incisions. So the problem with circumareolar incision in very young women is that you may end up cutting into ducts, the terminal ducts that come to the nipple areola, and they may have difficulty in feeding at a later date. They also have a tendency to form breast abscesses and breast infections during lactation. So the circumareolar incision, you have to think twice before making it. In the lower quadrant lesions, you could do with an inframammary skin crease incision. In the outer quadrant lesion, you could do with the axillary incision, which will avoid a scar in the breast. If you're doing a circumareolar, try and avoid the inner quadrant circumareolar incision, because there for 30-40% of the areolar nerve supply and therefore nipple sensation depends on that. A cut there could actually denervate, and not entirely the nipple sensation will be lost, but about 30-40%. So be careful about planning incisions there. So this is what we call as Chrysal's lines. You know, you, particularly in a ptotic breast, if you bunch up the skin together, it automatically forms some creases. And along the crease, if you incise and use a nice fine monocrule to stitch it up, the scar is hardly seen at a later date. So if you do circumareolar, don't cut into the ducts. So you make a skin cut and the dermis cut, and then actually make a skin flap, tunnel your way up, and then wherever the fibroadenoma is, just enter into the breast tissue there, rather than cutting into the breast tissue at this point, because this is where all the terminal ducts come up, and cutting into it directly down will definitely cut into the ducts. And so lesions in the periphery, you could do an incision in the axillary skin crease. So, and quite often when we try and minimize the size of the incision, we end up using this diathermy, and the skin edges get burnt by diathermy. And so use a rubber shot always, and use only 2 or 3 millimeters of the diathermy tip available. If you don't use a rubber shot, invariably you either touch the retractor or the skin surface, it burns, and then it leads to an ugly scar and sometimes keloid formation. And always, you know, it's very tempting to shell out a fibroadenoma. If it's a very clear, benign looking lesion, you can actually shell it out. But if there is a doubt otherwise, then these are the lesions that should be taken with the margin and orient the margin for the pathologist, whatever way that is suitable for you. And this is important because you may have a histological surprise that it is a malignancy or a phyllodes. And then if you have a margin oriented, if margin is clear, you don't have to go back for a second surgery. So it's important to orient yourself. So the one other thing that can mimic a fibroadenoma is phyllodes. So phyllodes, obviously, just forget this, these two lines. So this has been revised now. It's not 3 centimeters anymore. So the phyllodes actually, they can be classified into benign, intermediate, and malignant. The benign lesions look like fibroadenoma. The only thing is, phyllodes happens in the in a woman who's 30, 35 years and above, whereas fibroadenomas occur, like I said, in the early reproductive age group. So in an older woman, if there is a lump, even though it's benign looking, I said, you always biopsy there. So these are the, you have to differentiate it from all the well-differentiated cancers that I mentioned earlier and phyllodes. So phyllodes, if you suspect phyllodes, or if the core biopsy says there are a number of mitoses you look at, and sometimes they may not be able to differentiate clearly from a phyllodes to a fibroadenoma on a core biopsy. So the pathologist will give a differential diagnosis saying that I cannot rule out a phyllodes. So those are the cases where you have to go back and excise. When you excise, like I said, remove with the margin. So these phyllodes, that factors that distinguish it from fibroadenoma, one, it grows rapidly, and there are some cleft-like spaces on ultrasound. So particularly in larger ones, because they keep growing so much, the tissue sometimes undergoes necrosis and the echogenicity will be different, and there will be some spaces which look different with on ultrasound. So if you see this here, this again is a circumscribed rounded lesion. One margin is not very clear. You actually see a bit of halo as well here, but because it's rounded and also on ultrasound, look at this. It is quite ovoid, but you know there are areas of different echogenicities within the lesion. This is what we call as cleft-like spaces within the lesion. So if you find like this, if this is there in a lactating woman, then I might think that, you know, if she had a pre-existing fibroadenoma, I've seen that before, and then she becomes pregnant and comes to me like this, and I see this, then I will take it as it is lactating fibroadenoma and leave it. But if it's a new lesion and it looks like this, then this phyllodes has to be thought of. And again, here, if you look, it's an older woman, fatty breast, big lesion, palpable, quite close to the skin as well. And see the ultrasound again. These things tend to grow so fast. When they grow, they end up the central part of it loses its vascularity, and then it actually degenerates, and that part appears with a different echo texture. So you get a very mixed, it's not uniformly hypoechoic, it's a very mixed echogenic lesion. So these lesions obviously needs to be biopsied. So this can also happen with the aggressive triple negative tumors. They grow so fast that the central portion of this tumor becomes necrotic, and that's why when you do an unguided port biopsy, your needle passes through the necrotic tissue. The pathologist will not be able to tell you, and they say only necrotic tissue here, I cannot give a diagnosis. So that's why guided port biopsies are important, because you can actually guide your needle into the most significant area for a biopsy and avoid all these necrotic spots. So this is again a routine screening. So she had an ovoid looking lesion, and then because this margin was not so clear, and that there was some blood vessels here, and that she was 42 years. No, she had a symptomatic lady. She had a right breast lump for 3 months. So because of this appearance, we did a biopsy, and it turned out to be a phyllodes. So that actually sums it all. So 60% of fibroadenomas occur in the early reproductive age group, soon after menarche. Anytime it can happen. They can be multiple. Some of them are symptomatic. Many may not even know that they have. And these lesions, when ultrasound features are clearly benign, no suspicious features, then you don't probably need even a biopsy. You just need to follow them up six months, for a 2-6 months period. But if there is even one suspicious feature, or if it's a slightly older woman, then these lesions should be biopsied. And if there is any rad path discordance, then it should be excised. And when you excise with a margin and as cosmetically favorable incision as possible. So do we have time? Should I proceed with cysts or leave it for another day?
No, I think you can leave it for another day. And we had hope, because we just got about 12-13 minutes for discussion. So I'll open this for discussion, and if anyone wants to comment or question. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please identify yourself and put your camera on, but that'd be nice if you can.
Everybody's hiding low.
Anyone want to ask a question? You can.
Hello.
Yes, hello.
Ma'am, what's the medical treatment for fibroadenoma?
There is no medical treatment, except that I have used in a couple of patients Zoladex. So this very young woman, they have sometimes, you know, the breast is only fibroadenoma, there's hardly any normal tissue. And if you start excising them, the breast becomes so misshapen and disfigured. So it's obviously hormonal influence that it's provoking its formation. So treating them with gonadotropin releasing hormone antagonists, like what we use for malignancies, isn't it? Zoladex or loperamide. So this actually can, we don't like to give it long term again, because it we have to weigh its use against the disadvantages. They obviously need to have calcium supplements as well, because the long term usage, as they are at risk of developing osteoporosis, and we have to warn them that their periods might get irregular, and periods may actually take time to become normal. So this is should be used with a lot of caution. I have used it only for 2 patients so far, and I've not exceeded the more than 6 months.
Yeah, Dr. Selva Ganesh, please. Dr. Selva Ganesh, yeah. You can ask your question, unmute yourself. Okay, any other question from anyone? Please unmute yourself and ask the question. Subhra Kochar.
Ma'am?
Yeah.
What is the natural history of a fibroadenoma? Somebody has a fibroadenoma. Is it going to disappear? Is it going to involute? Is it going to grow? What is going to happen to them?
So about 30% of it may involute. Like the rest of the breast tissue, I told you that the fibroadenomas behave exactly like breast tissue, encapsulated breast tissue. So about 30% of them may involute on its own spontaneously without you interfering at all. Some of them again have particularly fibroadenomas that see a pregnancy, lactation and all that, they undergo some myxoid degeneration. And any degeneration anywhere in the tissue, it calcifies, isn't it? And then it may actually look like those macrocalcifications, popcorn-like lesions that I showed you earlier. So then it becomes a little hard nodule like a stone inside the breast, and it doesn't go away, it remains. But rarely they may just remain like that. It ages like breast tissue.
Does it answer your question, JP?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, Meghna.
Good morning, ma'am. Ma'am, this question was asked in my final Viva, that if we have planned accordingly, according to a fibroadenoma, and we have excised it, sent for a histopathological examination, and it comes out to be a malignant or a ductal carcinoma, so how do we proceed?
So this is why you should not have an unplanned excision. So core biopsy, which is why is why I keep insisting time and again that it's mandatory. So if you have a histological surprise, provided that you have oriented well and have a clear margin, then you need to look at whether a central lymph node biopsy is applicable or axillary clearance is required. And Also, go back and look at our mammograms. And is there any more than one lesion? Is there anything surrounding DCIS that you could have potentially missed? So look at all those features again. And if you're happy that you have given a good margin and excised that lesion, whatever that was excised that came as histological surprise, if the margins are clear, then you could just go and do a axillary central lymph node biopsy or an axillary clearance as the situation may demand, and then proceed with the rest of the treatment like you would with any other malignancy.
Okay, thank you.
Is there a size criteria to excise a fibroadenoma?
So earlier we would say anything more than 3 centimeters, 5 centimeters, get it removed. Now, I think with time, what I have I do in practice now is look at the proportionate size of the breast versus the lump. So somebody with a breast cup that is D, a 3 centimeter fibroadenoma or even a 5 centimeter fibroadenoma may not actually look different or feel different in that breast. So she no need to go and remove that. Whereas in a B cup breast, a 3 centimeter fibroadenoma might look like a big rock in the breast. So that might need to be removed if she's conscious about it. So anything that is altering the shape of the breast, the configuration, because a fibroadenoma that looks prominent in the, say, upper quadrant or changes the way the breast looks, then that is something that needs to be removed. Otherwise, it's proportionate to the size of the breast. So what I normally do is ask them to come for a 2-6 months period follow-up, And in the 2-6 month period follow-up, if there is an increase in size, I do not look at 2 millimeter, 3 millimeter increase, because that there is a lot of subjectivity there. The way you keep the probe and the way you put your marks for the measurement may not be the same every time. And in an ovoid lesion, you could have diagonals that measure slightly differently every time you measure. So if something what is 3 centimeter become 4.5 or 5, then that is significant. So which is most of these patients need, if you are convinced that it's very benign looking fibroadenoma, most of these patients need a lot of reassurance. Obviously, they're all paranoid about, the only thing that they're looking for, is it malignant? So you tell them, no, it's not likely to be a cancer. It is a benign lesion. So you tell them very clearly. So this does not, so because it behaves like normal breast tissue, so this also, like normal breast tissue, can become malignant. There is no increased risk of this becoming malignant just because it's a fibroadenoma, which is what you're saying. And then you say this will not affect her married life. This will not affect her breastfeeding and pregnancy. And so you, obviously, if this increases in size or if there is any change on follow-up, then we'll deal with it as it comes. But otherwise, this can be followed up. So this message you have to clearly convey to them, that it is not malignant, that it is not going to become malignant in the future day just because it's there. Whatever risk the surrounding breast tissue has, the same risk this will also have. There is no additional risk of this becoming malignant. This will not affect her married life or a pregnancy or breastfeeding. This is what the parents want to know, no, when they bring a young lady. So this, if you convey clearly, most of them are happy to have it followed up. And they'll come back diligently for you at 6 months, and whenever you ask them to come. What I do is follow up for two 6 months period. So if all the textbooks, Western, whatever they say for 2 years, but with the volumes that I have, I feel if in 2-6 months period, if it doesn't grow, then I tell them, instruct them, if there is any change, you come back on your own, but otherwise I'll discharge you from work. Come back only if there is a new problem.
Yeah, Dr. Sinduja, I've got some questions. Sinduja, would you show up? You are there?
Yes, ma'am. I have a doubt. Like some very young patients come to us, they are FNAC proven fibroadenomas, but they have a significant tenderness, like it is very bothersome and they are not able to carry out their daily activities. Should we go ahead with such symptomatic patients for excision?
No. So I would not do an FNAC for a fibroadenoma. So there is a misconception that if it's benign looking, an FNAC is enough. Benign looking ones are the ones that definitely need core biopsy, because you're going to call it benign based on the biopsy, and you have to be more certain. So if there is any suspicion of malignancy, you're not going to leave it at that. You will still excise. But if you're going to call it benign and ignore it, then you have to be 100 or 200% sure that it's benign. So this is where I would insist on a core biopsy and not rely only on an FNAC. Point number two, the tenderness is not very rarely because of the fibroadenoma. There's a lot of crosstalk. The tenderness is not because that it is because of the fibroadenoma. Sometimes when they undergo necrosis, it can pain. But that usually is very, very rare. Most of these lumps are painless. The tenderness is not because of the fibroadenoma. The tenderness is because of the rest of the breast tissue. And it also behaves like breast tissue. Breast tissue changes with the hormonal cycle, progesteronic phase. Everybody is going to be nodular and painful. Most women in the post-ovulatory phase are tender and sore. So you have to explain to them that this is the reason. And if she still is concerned and very anxious, then yes, you may as well do it. Because if you don't do it, somebody else will do. But they need a lot of reassurance. And then on follow-up, again, if they keep complaining of that particular lump that is paining, then excise it. Telling them that excising may not relieve the pain and she may have pain in the breast again in the future. So this has to be clearly explained.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, one last question before we close, because I need to go to another Zoom. Please.
Hello.
Hello.
Ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
First of all, an amazing session. Thank you for the videos and the pictures. Now, I have a question. I know of a 23-year-old young female patient. She'd undergone multiple consultations for a small, I think roughly about 2 centimeter size breast lump. Now, so I'm like a PG student myself. Now, that patient apparently had initially shown like a gynecologist, and then an ultrasound was done. And the ultrasound was suggestive of a BI-RADS 3 fibroadenoma. She was advised an FNAC, but then I think she went for a second opinion, probably to a surgeon or something. So like she'd been around a while. Now, eventually they decided that they wanted to go for an excision. The excision went without an event, but the biopsy report was suggestive of an intraductal carcinoma with hyalinizations and everything. Now, that report did not really favor, I mean, it did not really correlate too well clinically. So somebody went for a second opinion regarding the biopsy. Now, the second opinion biopsy suggested a skin adnexal tumor and less likely to be breast malignancy. And they said that, okay, a further IHC confirmation would be warranted. So is this like a likely possibility or a common scenario?
It's a very unusual situation. It can very, I mean, I have seen 2 or 3 like these myself. It can happen. It is an unusual, adnexal tumors can happen like anywhere else in the body. It can happen in the breast too. So adnexal tumor, obviously the lump would have been attached to the skin. It will not be on ultrasound clinically, you would both clinically and ultrasound, you would actually see that it is closer to the skin and actually tethering the skin.
Right, so the pinching and all should not be so very well appreciated.
Very well. So this lady, again, you know, anything that looks different or suspicious have a low threshold to biopsy. Biopsy, I mean core biopsy. And core biopsy, depending on what it shows, then something that's tethered to the skin, you may not ignore it, isn't it? You would still excise it along with that skin and margin, and it should have a clear diagnosis. So adnexal tumors, again, based on your immunohistochemistry, then we need to look at whether anything further is seen. Many of them, adnexal tumors, it doesn't behave like a typical breast malignancies. That excision would suffice. Obviously, you look at the nodes and then leave it with the medical oncologist to decide whether they want to do anything further.
So, I guess like
thank you so much. I end the meeting here. We'll meet Dr.Selvi again tomorrow, same time. Thank you, Dr.Selvi.
Thank you so much. Thank
tomorrow,
you.
Tomorrow, I may not be able to come at the same time. Some other time, I'll fix up with you later.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.